I'm going to talk about what we currently have issues in open source licenses. I'm from the site of Cologne, and my colleague Karina, which actually submitted the talk, she's from Berlin. So the German Aerospace Center is a research organization of the German government. We're doing research on transportation, space research, energy, and aeronautics. And we're also German Space Agency, among other things. Very distributed within Germany, with 20 sites currently, 8,000 employees, and about like 5,500 are scientists, actually. And also we have Brussels offices outside of Germany, like here in Brussels or in Paris, Tokyo, and so on. And within our lab, within the German Aerospace Center, we have a lot of software, and a lot of this is open source and free software. This is actually a picture 2 years ago here at Foston, which I took, of somebody you might know. So the software scene and software development at DLR is very diverse. So we have many, many domain scientists from aeronautics and space and so on. All of them have certain thoughts and things in their minds, and usually they are implementing their ideas into software packages. That's the basic way of working. And so software development at DLR, at our lab, is very important. Like 1,500 people are working full-time on software development. That means we spend 150 million euros per year personal cost for software development, and it makes us one of the largest software companies, if you will, in Germany at least. But actually, we are not a company. It's the characteristics. The people who are developing software, and this is very similar to other similar organizations like research labs and maybe also universities, is that our developers have no training in software development at all. So some of them had like programming courses at universities, like course in C programming or Python, or other colleagues have courses in Fortran programming and so on. And the problem is that they have no education, but now have to do a huge amount of the time doing in software projects, actually. And yeah.
So what is their expertise? Why did you hire them? They're all space experts? Or?
Yeah, space experts, domain experts for aeronautics and transportation and all this kind of stuff. And they just have to do programming work because this is essential in every scientific field today, like especially in the field of where we are doing a lot of data science and so on. And a lot of these people many of these people for our colleagues don't work on huge software projects actually, but they do something like exploratory programming, like small scripts or entering a bits of code in Jupyter notebooks and so on. And we use a lot of technologies, more than 30 programming languages, like with Fortran and ADA and MATLAB and Python and so on. And we use a lot of open source software, and we produce a lot of open source software with many different licenses. And that's where part of the problems come in. So we have a huge number of software projects. One of our problems is that we don't have a real overview about our software projects. So it's very heterogeneous from the organization point, and it's very hard to get an overview, and it's just not possible today. And regarding open source software, usually the software starts within the lab and then it's exposed with an open source license to the outer world. Here are three examples from the Earth system modulation field, from traffic simulation, and from aerospace design. And these software packages are used from other researchers or from other companies, and contributors come from also from other research labs and universities and also from companies. Problems that we have, or that we had in the past, is that we published open source, that we had issues with licenses, so things which I'm not going to really talk about, but one of the things that happened is that our government, Germany, gave software away to another country and stated it was open source. It is open source, and it was not. This was the software of our lab, of DLR. And, there was a journalist from the Spiegel magazine, and he discovered that, and just there was a little, well, trouble coming up. So we fixed this with a lot of effort, and then we had a couple of other problems with where the license compatibility was not fulfilled and so on. And in general, colleagues didn't know about open source licenses and which license to choose and so on. And the problems that we have are not as problematic as like with our hardware. This is much more expensive, but it's also also not nice, and we try to avoid it. And like in 2012, there was a letter by our CIO who sent a letter to all the employees with some tips and warnings about open source and dealing with open source licenses and so on. And but the situation is really complicated because if you are a developer, and especially a researcher, which are not interested in software engineering and programming and in license issues, it's really hard to understand licensing and open source licensing in particular. For example, at the ICPC conference last year, there was a talk about a study. Do software developers understand open source licensing? And well, the general conclusion is that developers understand open source licensing if there's one license involved, but it's really if they struggle if there are multiple licenses involved. And this is usually in most projects, this is the case, that we don't have just one license, but we have multiple licenses. And we have also issues of license compatibility and so on. And, well, what we try to do in the past years is to took some actions for our colleagues, for our employees. For example, information, we provide information, trainings, knowledge exchange possibilities, and consulting and support. And I'm going through all of this briefly. So information and trainings, what we set up was a training for open source licensing. It's not about developing software. It's only about the legal issues on licenses, and it's a regular training in our education program of DLR, so every employee can sign up every year, and it's a short training, only 4 hours, like from 10 to 3 p.m. or so, and it's run by two persons, a legal expert for the real legal topics, and second person is a software engineer, and together we are presenting the basic stuff about licensing and how to select open source licenses and how to use open source software. And it took place in various sites at DLR throughout the years, and a couple of people from different institutes attended. And the people who came there, most of them didn't have very deep knowledge about open source licenses. So that's our main audience with these trainings. So when we ask prior to training, so nobody said that he or she has deep knowledge about licensing issues and the topics of the training. We also asked them for the expectation on the trainings. We got a lot of feedback, what people want to learn, overview about licenses and so on, learn about the legal basics, and the feedback after the training shows us that we fulfilled the expectations of our colleagues. At least the ratings were good or very good. So this turned out very well. And what we also did is like a brochure, like in real paper, and information about legal basics. It's developed by a law firm in Germany from Berlin, and funded from DLR sources, and the open source brochure contains a couple of chapters and sections about distribution of unmodified code and modified code. It has lists of all liabilities for licenses which are widely used at DLR, for example the BSD or Apache license and so on, and covers of course the concepts like copyleft and so on. And this is one page of the open source brochure which we distribute in our lab. Is we have checklists, so colleagues can go to this checklist and mark all the points if they the projects fulfill these points. And it also has a lot of information about very different things related to open source and software development. And it also has some kind of decision trees for example, for choosing a license for their own projects. This brochure is in German only currently, but we are working on an English version on a Creative Commons license, which we can distribute in the future, like this year somewhere. Next thing is knowledge exchange between our colleagues. The first thing that comes to mind when you think about knowledge exchange is a wiki, and also we set up a wiki in our central wiki installation, where we have wiki pages for everything. And there's now since a couple of years there's an open source section with question and answer section and information and link lists and so on. And this is like the single source of information, single point of information for open source issues at DLR. And I think this is very common and standard, but what we also set up is kind of workshops, knowledge exchange workshops. This is for peer-to-peer exchange between our colleagues, which come to a place together. And we have these knowledge exchange workshops for different topics at DLR, like for software engineering and visualization and photonic systems and so on, but also for open source and also open science and open access and these kind of topics. This is currently open for any DLR employee. Currently, we have a limit of 60 participants per workshop. This is an interactive program, short lectures, and everybody has to introduce it himself or herself, and we have lightning talks and discussions in small groups and so on. So, for example, last year, everybody had to make a small poster introducing herself. Actually, this is Karina, who was supposed to talk here now. And then we can go around to the posters, and everybody can ask questions and explain what he wants and what he offers and so on. And, well, of course, sometimes it's hard to understand what people offer. That is also one of the problems that we have very strange minds in our lab, and they are thinking about concepts like how to integrate satellites into an industry 4.0 infrastructure. And then if you have to go to them and ask about the open source licensing, then they basically explode. So this is the interesting part of the job. And also we gathered the feedback for our workshops and for the different topics, and also for the expectations that people have. And the most important expectation was to get knowledge from other people within the same lab, from colleagues which have the same problems. And the feedback form showed us that we fulfilled this expectation. So we will continue with this kind of workshops, internal workshops for knowledge exchange. And we have a lot of findings which came out of these workshops which we can use for further actions and further activities within DLR. Well, very general findings which we in part already know before, that we use open source a lot, and that this, people want to publish open source more and more and so on. And there were also critics of open source software, and we discussed these topics too, for example, for like things like earning money and the business aspects and so on. And one of the things was that we needed a formal process definition and what to do for employees if they want to publish the software as open source. This was missing. It's now available because we developed it in the last year. So this was one of the outcomes of these kind of software knowledge exchange workshops. And of course, another topic that we set up, another area is help and consulting. If people at DLR have problems related to any kind of licensing or any kind of open source issue, there are actually a couple of departments who might help, for like the technology marketing division. They help in general licensing questions and topics like property rights and so on. We have the legal department, of course, who can support them for general legal questions or copyright questions. And we have a software technology division who helps in license selection and all things related to development. And of course, during these support actions, we have typical topics are what are criteria for choosing an open source software, or what are best practices for your own open source project, and so on. And what we set up for this, and this, we found out that this is also very important, just a very simple single email address, opensource@dlr.de, and any employee can send an email to this address, and we will help these guys. And well, of course, everybody from outside of DLR can send us emails to this address, and we will probably help these guys. Yeah, and what we also did is that we choose a couple of licenses which were approved by our legal department, which colleagues and employees can use without further asking anybody, like the simplified BC license, the Apache license 2.0, and the Eclipse public license. These two licenses are really widely used at DLR for a variety of projects. And of course, we have a lot of other licenses which we are using, but if one of the colleagues want to use one of these licenses, they don't have to ask anybody again. And another thing, we decided a couple of years ago that we don't go and develop our own license. A couple of related institutions are doing this, like the European Space Agency and NASA and so on. They all have their own open source license or their own license, and we decided just that the existing licenses, the existing open source OSI approved licenses are enough for our projects, and that's it. It works in practice, so there's really no need for our own license. And for support and help also, we have a section in the wiki, and where there's a discussion board and Q&A section, which is very, very frequently used currently. So I think I'm through. So the key messages of my talk here are that we at DLR, our strategy was regarding to open source licensing is that we first offered specific information to our employees and provided room and space and time for peer-to-peer discussions and for knowledge exchange. And then afterwards, we came up with formal process definitions and something was just given from the board of directors and so on. And we have positive evaluations for all of our actions, and so we can continue on this road, and also other research organizations, at least in Germany, but also currently in the US, are like copying this kind of way that we are going. Okay, that's it. Thank you. And if you have questions, just ask. Thanks. Yeah, no.
You say that you like to allow, spread of knowledge rather than directives from above. But it seems like when it comes to choosing licenses, you're not actually giving your engineers that much choice. Obviously, one of the big choices in license choice is whether you use copyleft or not. And the three approved licenses by default had no copyleft, and I think a little bit of copyleft. So one of the most difficult decisions is not, in fact, in front of them. So I can see how that would make it easy, but
I
have you just decided not to use copyleft licensing?
Yeah.
DLR.
That's just a question. It's too long to repeat. So the question is basically, why do we choose only licenses which do not have copyleft in it? And this was not by intention. So we just came up with these few licenses because a lot of people ask for specifically these licenses. And it's totally possible that we add another license like GPL or other licenses to this list. It's just the current state. So, okay? So in
is this the list that you're producing software or the list of licenses that you're using?
That the license that you're using for software that we initiate.
Okay.
Yeah. I think you was first.
Just to get a feel for how big an organization, what organizations do that work for them is a function of how big they are. How big roughly is DLR in terms of number of employees?
Oh, the question is how big is DLR in employees? We are currently more than 8,000 employees.
8,000.
Yeah. No. Do we have a public domain in Germany? As far as I know, we cannot do this in Germany. Yeah, but I'm not the legal expert. Yeah. Yes.
But for instance, if I were a DLR developer, I could choose the copyleft license after passing through the department.
Yeah.
Have you got any experience about some of yours tried this way? Like, I want to choose a copyleft license.
Yes.
And ask.
So the question is, can people choose a copyleft license? And if you have experience with employees doing that, yes, we have a lot of experience. Many projects of DLR have, for example, GPL, LGPL, or other copyleft licenses. And it's not only the legal department where we have to go through, but also actually you must convince your manager, actually. But that's a side note. But in general, a lot of people did that before, yes, also for copyleft licenses. No, we look into, the question is, in what basic is it accepted or not? So we, in each case, we look into the specifics of the project, and does it make sense? Does the license make sense? And in some cases, we, like my department or other people, suggest other licenses, and sometimes we just say, yes, this is okay, and so on. Yeah. But especially this project is currently a bit more formalized with decision trees and so that people can make the step for choosing license by themselves more and more. Okay. Okay. Yes. So the question is, do we provide the actions and services to external parties? Yes, sometimes. For example, we did it a couple of times for other research institutions in Germany, universities and research labs. And also in one case for a company, but this is not our main focus. Okay, yes? Sorry, can you repeat?
Why not push all the DLR programmers with one license as opposed to permitting this?
Ah, okay. So, yeah. So the question is, why do not push everybody to use these licenses?
One license,
especially one license. Yes. No. This is a strategy which we tried out before, in for RISE technologies, for programming languages, for licenses, for development infrastructure, and in a really free mind research environment like DLR, this is not going to work. So people want to do their own stuff, their own way, their own license, and so on. And so we have to provide offers, but we do not make pressure on them to choose just one single license.
Because you can't or because you don't want to?
We don't want to. No, that doesn't conform to our way of free thinking and do what you like, basically. Okay? Thanks.